being the head of your home means winning every preference point in your home, you're not a loving person. And you will reap into your family the consequences and the fallout of failing at the bullseye of following Jesus, which is love.
Dad, our church has really grown in these videos. Man, there's a lot of people.
Yeah, just ever since we went on TV, the whole thing's just exploding. Actually, if you watch the next program, I mean, it's even bigger.
Yeah.
And the reason is because while God is blessing our church, these are actually conferences. Mm-hmm. And myself and Matt Chandler and Greg Laurie and other friends of ours were sharing this conference that we pulled together, and just very, very thankful for the opportunity to stand before men and proclaim to them what the Word says about the life that Christ rose from the dead so we could live.
Amen.
Here's the sentence that takes me to the end of this message. Here's the sentence that best describes what I'm going for. Here's the first part. On the majors, action. On the majors, action. Notice 1 Corinthians 13, verse 6. I'll come back for 4 or 5 in a minute. Speaking of love, it says, it does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love does not rejoice in iniquity. Love rejoices in the truth. Love is not happy about evil doing. Love is happy about doing good. Love is not protective of meanness. Love is protective of kindness. And so you have to ask yourself the question, is this a major? Is this a major thing? Is this something I have to take a stand about? You don't have to take action on everything, men. Nobody wants you to go home from this conference and start choking every single issue with renewed intensity. Don't do that. So, there comes a time when you have to, though, take action in regard maybe to your son. Maybe something in your marriage. Here's three things to help you decide, is this a major? Three things. Is this a major? Is this something I gotta do? Do I gotta do something about this? How many men would agree that sometimes I made a big deal about nothing and sometimes I didn't do anything about something major? Put up both hands if you've done that. Okay? So thank you for your honesty. So now we need some kind of a grid. Is this an action thing? Because I went to that act like men thing. I'm kind of fired up now. Okay? So here it is. Is it a major? Number one, is it critical path? Just ask yourself, is this critical path? Would failure to take action on this produce major fallout? Is this a major doctrinal issue? Is this marital unfaithfulness? Is this a criminal act? Is this abusive behavior? If something like that is going on, major doctrine, marital unfaithfulness, a criminal act, an abusive behavior. If something like that's going on, don't collect stories for 3 years and decide if you're going to do something. The time for action on that is now, today, prayerfully, you know, this week. On the majors, this is love. You listening? This is love. Love does not rejoice in iniquity. It rejoices in the truth. This is love. I'm not turning off the love button to go truth. This is love. This on the majors action. So is it critical path? Here's a second question to ask. Some of you are thinking about something that's been going on with your daughter. Some of you are thinking about something you've been really burdened about with your wife and one of her relationships. Is this major? All right. Is it critical path? Secondly, is it a chronic problem? This isn't one time. I don't fly off the handle at my son because he was rude at the dinner table. I don't make this into some big ego point. You're not gonna talk to your mother like that. And okay, I won't talk to mom like that anymore. but how, when will I be old enough to say that I think you're probably not supposed to talk to me like that either? Shut up! Okay, so you don't fly off the handle. Maybe your son had a terrible day at school. Maybe something happened that's been very devastating to him. There's probably something behind that behavior, and love's gonna find out what was really going on there instead of taking everything as an affront to my ego and my leadership in this house and starting a war over everything just because it kind of insults me a little bit. Clear? So, is it critical path? Is it a chronic problem? It's not that my son was had a bad day. I was out of town. He was rude to his mother every single day. And I'm not gonna scream at him and I'm not gonna shame him, but I'm gonna sure get him somewhere in private and we're gonna have a conversation about how this needs to be playing out a lot differently and why. Is it critical path? Is it a chronic problem? If it's going on all the time, you can say to somebody, you know, is it possible that gossip is really becoming an issue here? And I hear you saying things and repeating things. We can't be even confident that that's true. There are things that you, maybe the problem is at home. Ecclesiastes says the little foxes spoil the vine. And if it's critical path, it's major. If it's chronic and ongoing all the time, it's major. And then here's the last one. If it's close proximity, okay? It's major because it's not my neighbors, it's not my in-laws, it's my house. People that sleep under my roof, my responsibility. No, we're not buying that. We can't afford it. I can't support that. I will never support what I know will hurt you. That's a big parenting sentence. I can never support what I know will hurt you. I can never applaud what I know will lead to your pain. I can never make it easier for you to sin. I love you. Why would I help you down the road of suffering? Why would I do that? There are things you can live with in your neighbors and your friends that you can't live with in your own family. So choose the majors: critical path, chronic problem, and close proximity. So you say, man, I got one. It's chronic and it's close. It's critical and it's chronic. If it's got one or two of those, you got something now you got to deal with. And so now the next question is then how does love, how? Guys, you don't pitch love because you have something now that needs to be dealt with. You don't strap on your camo and you know, get your army boots on. I'm going to go deal with this. The wrath of man, again, does not produce the righteousness of God. And I've been appointed by God to take leadership and take responsibility and to bring some influence to bear upon that problem. But I'm not going to step outside the arena of love, or I'm not going to be helping God get this done. So we have here in the text some very clear instructions. Start looking in verse 4. If you have to deal with something, here's how you're going to do it. Number one, I'll start in verse 5. It does not insist on its own way. Love is not rude. It is gracious. There's no place for aggressive, boisterous, obnoxious confrontation. That's not love. And then it says that love does not seek its own. Anytime I'm going to communicate something that's difficult to say to someone, my need is to be liked, my need is to be appreciated, my need is to be heard, and I'm not going to put my needs out front. I'm prepared to be refused this time and not blow up. I'm prepared to have someone say, I don't want to hear that from you, and I'm not going to, yeah, well, you're going to hear it. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to seek my own. If now isn't a good, well, I'm going to pray for you because I love you, and I'm going to make another try to talk to you about this in a little while. You need to calm down, and I'm going to come back. And what do men do? Even if I can motivate you to make a move that is loving, if it doesn't go good, we revert right back to force, strength. And it's so, so destructive. Love does not act unbecomingly. It doesn't seek its own. It's not provoked. I won't be aroused to anger if the response is negative or combative. I won't return the same. That's not love. Love does not take into account a wrong suffered. I'm not coming to talk to my daughter with the baggage of how she hurt me last weekend. I'm not coming to talk to my spouse carrying the weight of my own disappointment in my marriage right now. I'm not going to bring my own issues to bear upon my leadership of my home. I'm going to lean on my brothers for the help. Let me say this. Any time I have initiated action with hurt as a major component of my action, I have regretted it. Nothing that I have ever done that has been motivated and driven by someone hurting me has ever worked out good, ever. Sometimes I have had to be silent for months in a church to get over the hurt so that I could raise it in a way that was productive and helpful to God's agenda. So I don't take into account a wrong suffered. How many men could honestly confess that the things that have brought them the most consternation and have been the most relationally devastating in their family in the last month have not been about major things?
One of the things James and I have seen over and over again is that when God gets a hold of a man's heart, it's not just one life transformed, it's a family. The marriage becomes solid, the children feel secure, relationships are restored, and you can just see generations are changing because a man has come under God's authority. Being a godly man is certainly not an easy role, and for sure our world is sending men confusing messages and promoting things that are so contrary to what God says, really leading them away from what God knows is best and most fulfilling for them. I couldn't be any happier that my husband James has written Act Like Men.
Men are in trouble. From porn to paternity, the men of our country are in dire need of a better direction. What men need is a new path, one that leads them to act like men. We'd like to send you the new book by James MacDonald, Act Like Men, 40 Days to Biblical Manhood. Discover how to become the man God created you to be, and learn how He can transform your life in ways you never imagined possible. Act Like Men is a book that every husband, son, and man should own, read, and live. Call now and ask for the Act Like Men book when you give a gift of any amount to Walk in the Word. And by supporting this ministry with a gift of $100 or more, we'll also send you Straight Talk, Loving Your Neighbor. In this 15-message collection, you'll learn that God's transforming truths are the best way to love the people in your life. And if you call right now, you'll also receive, as a bonus, the Valentine's Date Night DVD, where James and Kathy share how they've kept their marriage strong and their hearts close to each other and Christ. Call right now and ask for Straight Talk when you call 800-545-6800 or go now to jamesmacdonald.tv.
On the major's action, and let me say this, most things are not majors. Are you listening? I'm not the smartest guy at this conference or in the top 100 for sure. So it's a pretty simple point, but it might be the most important sentence in this message for you. Most things are not majors. On the majors action, but most things are not majors. How many men could honestly confess that the things that have brought them the most consternation and have been the most relationally devastating in their family in the last month have not been about major things? Lift up your hand if that's true for you. And so we have these strong people that God made to lead, but we take hold of things because of our pride that should be left alone. They're not major. It's your pride that's wounded, not God's character. It's your ego that got bruised, not God's reputation. And some of you are bullies. You're just bullies in your own home. And people are relieved when you're asleep. and they walk on eggshells because everyone has felt the pain of your anger. And it's not right. It's sin, and you need to repent of it. You need to go home and humble yourself in front of your family. Some of you need to get on your knees in front of your spouse and say, I've been so wrong. No one deserves to be talked to the way that I've talked to you. No one deserves to be treated. You clean my clothes. You make our meals. You serve this family. And I'm so selfish. I'm so demanding. And I'm so sorry. On the minors, and most things are minors, acceptance. Here's some minor things. Preference issues. Preference issues. How loud the music is. Go in another room. You know? I have a guy small group that I'm in, and we were in the kitchen the other day at my house, and what do you call those little cup coffee?
Keurig.
Perfect. We have one of those. And I wanted to make my buddies this coffee Keurig thing. But the Keurig thing was in one corner of the kitchen, and the basket with the K-cups was in the other corner of the kitchen, in a basket, all nicely on the side of the stove with some stuff around it. So I said, hey, let me get you one of those cups. And I'm walking over here, you know, about that far. I'm reaching up here, and I'm bringing the cups back. And he asks the obvious question, why are those way over there? I answer, because I'm married. Like, I've made the form speech. Honey, this is not a model home. This is where we live. I'm a big fan of function. Seems to me the cups could go right beside the Keurig. Is that intuitive to anyone else here but me? Now, I just want you to know. I want you to know my wife's here with me. She won't be upset by this because I have lost. She said, I'm glad you can enjoy telling that story to your brothers. It will not change. Now, should I go home now? Because I was with my brothers this weekend. Should I go home and set that right? No, I should not. If being the head of your home means winning every preference point in your home, you're not a loving person. And you will reap into your family the consequences and the fallout of failing at the bullseye of following Jesus, which is love. Watching is awesome. Standing firm in the faith is great. Being strong is essential. But let all that you do be done in love. You're not acting like a man. If you're not letting all that you do be done increasingly, entirely, out of you before me, love. So, on the minor's acceptance, on the minor's acceptance, and that's why we have verse 4, love is patient. It means literally long-tempered, persistent, compassionate in the face of opposition. One of Abraham Lincoln's earliest enemies was Edwin M. Stanton. Edwin M. Stanton called Abraham Lincoln a low, cunning clown. He called Lincoln the original gorilla. He said in the newspapers of the day, quote, it was ridiculous for people to go to Africa to see a gorilla when they could find one easily in Springfield, Illinois, at the residence of Abraham Lincoln, end quote. But love is patient, and love is kind, active goodwill, not just passively accepting, but actively showing kindness. Lincoln never responded to the slander, but when, as president, he needed a Secretary of War, he chose Stanton to be his Secretary of War, the guy that called him a gorilla, the guy who said, you can go to Africa. Why go to Africa when you can see an ape right here at Abraham Lincoln's house? He made him the Secretary of War. When his incredulous friends asked Lincoln why he had done that, he replied, because he's the best man. Years later, as the slain president's body laid in state, Stanton looked into the coffin and said through his tears, here's what he said, "There lies the greatest ruler of men the world has ever seen." His animosity was finally broken by Lincoln's long-suffering, non-retaliatory spirit. Patient love won out. God's word says love is patient. Love is kind. And then I love these two. Love isn't jealous. Love isn't jealous. I accept you even when you are more successful than me, more prominent than me, more recognized than me, more rewarded than me. I'm for you. I always have been. I always will be. I rejoice in your success. I will not have a jealous attitude toward my brother. I will not let his success sour my love. I will revel in it. Love is not jealous. And then this, love does not brag. It is not arrogant. So I accept you when you're more successful than me. Some of you need to let go of your jealousy and envy toward your brothers. But I also accept you when you're less successful than me. I won't brag. I'm not arrogant. I am for you. I will not make you uncomfortable by boasting in my success. I will not highlight my life in a way that embarrasses or belittles you. And then finally, love bears all things. It believes all things. It hopes all things. It endures all things. On the major's action, on the minor's acceptance, in all things, love. Say it. In all things, love. Say it. Or as the theme passage says, let all that you do be done in love. Listen, men. Of the themes that men have known, one supremely stands alone. Love is the theme. Love is supreme. Sweeter it grows, glory bestows, bright as the sun, ever it glows. Love is the theme. It's the eternal theme. And you're not God's man, and you're not acting like a man if everyone who knows you isn't saying, he is growing in love. So bow with me, please, in a word of prayer, in love. Father, we come before you in the strong name of your Son, Jesus. And we just want to say to you, Father, that you have, by your Spirit, convicted us that the greatest failures in our life are failures to love. Forgive us, God, for the lowliness and the littleness of our attitudes toward one another. Forgive us, God, for our harshness and our insistence that men be for us what only Jesus Christ can be. Grow us in love, God. Grow us in love, we pray. Let all that we do be done in love. Let our watching be in love. Let our standing in firm in the faith be done in love. Let our being strong be done in love.
All right, Dad, I got a question for you. Is that all right?
Uh-huh.
Okay, so why is it so hard for men to channel their intensity into the right things?
Well, first of all, let's just acknowledge that God made men with a capacity to be intense that exceeds the capacity in most instances of the fairer sex.
Yeah.
And men were made by God to lead, to take mountains, to protect, to fight for. Men have a big job, just like women do.
Yeah.
And with that intensity, though, comes, because we're fallen, because we're broken, because of sin, we tend to get intense about the wrong things. And every man knows the shame of seeing his God-given strength expressed in a way that isn't protecting, isn't preferring, isn't loving, isn't leading, but is actually hurting and tearing down the very things that he cares the most about. And so men with intensity directed in the wrong way are, you know, we can be pretty dangerous.
Yes, we can. And that's why I'm so excited about this book. You know, we very rarely, me and you, talk about a book sitting here.
Yeah, right.
But Like, I'm doing this with my small group. I got this Act Like Men book, and we're going through this together. And I'm so excited about this, and I really want our viewers at home to be able to get this in their hands.
Well, you know, I've been a pastor for almost 30 years, and I spend so much of my time dealing with the fallout of men who are in the ditch, off track. And so this isn't a bunch of sermons made into a book. I sat and wrote out of 30 years of my own life, my experience, trying and failing and trying again to be the man that God wants me to be. This isn't in any sermon. You can't order that. This is all written out in a study format. Men can feel overwhelmed by a book, but it's actually filled with God's Word, and it's 40 separate studies, one at a time. Every one of them is life-changing.
Amen. And we're going to tell you how you can get that right now.
We'd like to send you the new book by James MacDonald, Act Like Men, 40 Days to Biblical Manhood. Discover how to become the man God created you to be and learn how He can transform your life in ways you never imagined possible. Act Like Men is a book that every husband, son, and man should own, read, and live. Call now and ask for the Act Like Men book when you give a gift of any amount to Walk in the Word. And by supporting this ministry with a gift of $100 or more, we'll also send you Straight Talk, Loving Your Neighbor. You'll also receive, as a bonus, the Valentine's Date Night DVD. Call 800-545-6800 or go now to jamesmacdonald.tv.
Now, we know that was a heavy message today, and we preached it because there's heavy content in the Word of God. And we want you to know at home that we love and care about you, and we're really thankful that you're watching the program.
Don't you kind of relate to, I appreciate what you just said.
Yeah.
And don't you kind of relate to what Paul said in Galatians? He said, am I now your enemy because I tell you the truth? And I want you to know that bringing the truth to you faithfully, as we're attempting to do, is an immense responsibility that we take very, very seriously. So we love you, and let's stay in the Scriptures together. And that's where we find God's path and God's plan for our lives.
This program was paid for by the friends and partners of Walk in the Word.